for others to view if they weren't able to join us this evening. We're expecting about 328 people to join us tonight. We're most of the way there with our attendance, so I'm sure others will be joining us pretty shortly. So again, thanks for joining us this evening. I'm Derek Wirtz. I'm the Director of Field Service and Chief Operating Officer for the Council, and I'll be moderating this evening's roundtable program. We have quite a program lined up, and I think we've done our best to have a program that's valuable for everyone that's a part of it tonight. So let's go ahead and get started with our program, and we'll start with an opening video and the Pledge of Allegiance.
To the flag as a pledge to the ideals of our forefathers, the men who fought and died in the building of this great nation. It's a pledge to fulfill our duties and obligations as citizens of the United States, and to uphold the principles of our Constitution. And last but not least, it's a pledge to maintain the four great freedoms cherished by all Americans: freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom from want, and freedom from fear. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible,
Good evening again, everyone, and on your screen is a quick overview of what this evening's agenda will look like. We'll start with some announcements and updates. I have a presentation about Summer Camp 2020, talk a little bit about virtual programming, our Friends of Scouting campaign, some training information, and then we'll end with some final remarks. At the bottom of your screen is a Q&A button, so please use that throughout the evening to ask questions that you may have. And those will be monitored throughout the evening, and we'll do our best to have our panelists answer those questions as we go along. We have 17 great panelists this evening, and I want to thank each one of those for sharing their evening with us tonight and presenting for us. So to all of our panelists, thank you very much for everything you're doing for us this evening. Before you leave this evening, we'll ask you to take a few minutes and complete a feedback survey. There will be a link to that survey as you exit the Zoom meeting tonight. At this time, I'd like to welcome our Council Commissioner, John Errico, who will take us through some announcements and updates. John?
Thank you, Derek. Appreciate that. And welcome, everybody. First thing I'm going to talk about real quick is with respect to Unit of Honor. If you were a 2019 Unit of Honor recipient, those patches have indeed come in. We believe I got those out to at least four of the districts before their roundtables, before things kind of got shut down. So if you are expecting Unit of Honor patches, please reach out to your respective district executives. There's a high probability that they have them as they all were handed out at that point in time. I've received a couple of questions with respect to the 2020 Unit of Honor form and the requirements, and are we going to be making any kind of adjustments? And the answer is we will be making some adjustments to those to the requirements for the 2020 Unit of Honor form. There's some requirements that we know today that we can absolutely adjust. For example, Friends of Scouting presentation. In the original 2020 form, it indicated that all presentations needed to be concluded by June 30th. At this point in time, we will be extending that requirement out to September 30th for units. Another one of the requirements that is in there is with respect to new family engagement. And in there, we had encouraged units to hold some form of a spring recruitment during this time period. Unfortunately, as a lot of you know, our spring recruitment time period has been greatly affected by the current coronavirus. So we are going to remove this requirement and that you have a spring recruitment. However, we do expect that that you do continue to recruit on a full year basis as soon as you are able to. With respect to camping requirement, that particular requirement is still kind of up in the air at the moment. We are waiting to hear what's going to happen from a state level in terms of what we can do. So before we can make any kind of a modification to the camping requirement of Unit of Honor, I really need to wait and hear from the camping committee as well as from the state in terms of what we are going to be able to do. So that pretty much is a quick summary on the Unit of Honor. On the other item that I really quickly wanted to touch upon is we have some fundraisers or spring fundraisers that we're doing. And specifically, I'm going to touch upon the maple syrup and pancake mix fundraiser. By now, we're supposed to be done with it. We should be distributing the maple syrup and the product mix. Unfortunately, we've had to push those dates out. The sale has been extended again to June 15th, and unit orders will be due no later than June 19th. One of the nice things we have done, and it came at the request of a unit, is we've actually ordered, we have now set up, and I believe we pushed it out through social media and Twitter as well, that you can do a pre-order online. We are not gonna be shipping the product at all for the maple syrup or the pancake mix, but if you have somebody who wants to order pancake mix and maple syrup, they are to go to the website, they can order it. And what they have to have is the scout's name as well as the unit. It will be the unit's responsibility for getting the product to the to that individual who orders. With built into the order form as well is the capability for them to pay by credit card. So payment will be able to be handled all through that method. So we're trying to do our best in terms of adjusting the maple product sale and trying to help you guys out in terms of being able to do it. We still have seven more camperships to hand out. We have three that we've awarded thus far. And at this point in time, I'm aware of, I believe, two units that have met the, have sold over $1,000 in product, and they are gonna be eligible for some of the council or unit level prizes. So whatever you can do, we're doing our best to adapt and to adjust. And again, I know today I got an email from somebody who saw the announcement of being able to order product online via Twitter. So We are reaching people beyond our scouting community in terms of who wants to be able to support us. So when I do get those, I look up, if I know there's a unit in the area that's selling the product, I do send an email and communicate out to that unit and say you have a sale. So with that, I am done, Derek, and I'm gonna push this over to Josh Boucher.
So real quick update on adventure cards, along with the maple syrup sale. The adventure card sale was also extended to June 15th. The only thing we ask is that the amount of cards that you have sold to date, that you still do make the initial payment on May 12th. That way we can reevaluate the situation and see how the sale is going to June 15th. The other thing is we also ask that if you guys have any questions or concerns, please email me or communications at NH Scouting directly. And if anyone has any questions about adventure cards, please let me know. But it has been extended.
Good. Thanks, Josh. I think we have a question about the maple syrup sale. Tyler, do you have that question?
Yes. Thanks, Derek. The question, John, is from Brendan in Pack 56. Wants to know if the units can fulfill their maple syrup orders sooner than June.
If you feel that you've exhausted everything at this point in time, you absolutely can. I mean, it's going to be a matter of me being able, I've been working very closely with our suppliers in terms of the extending of our deadlines and everything. And they're willing to work with us in terms of what we can do. So short answer is that, and Brendan, you guys at PAC 56 have done a great job. And I know we've gotten two scouts from your unit that have earned camperships. So good job to those scouts. But absolutely, if you guys feel that you guys have done, you can absolutely submit it to me.
Great, thanks, John. Had a couple more questions about information for the online maple syrup sale. We'll be sending out additional follow-up information after tonight's webinar, in addition to some other communication. So the link will be made available that your scouts can share with families and friends throughout, as well as additional information regarding the online sales documentation. So we'll have that stuff sent out in a follow-up. And back to you, Derek.
Thanks, Tyler. I think everyone's familiar with the good turn that we have underway, the Scouting Helps Hospitals. So I'd like to ask Jim Merrill if he could give us an update on that and tell us how we can continue to help the hospitals throughout the state. Jim?
Thanks, Derek. I appreciate it. Good to be with you all this evening. As you know, a few weeks ago, in partnership with the New Hampshire Hospital Association, we announced the Scout Support Hospitals Initiative, with the goal being of having units statewide put together care packages to deliver to their local hospital to support our frontline healthcare workers as they deal with COVID-19. And the Hospital Association was and is very excited about that. They're very grateful. And so far we've had a great response from units. I believe we've made over a dozen deliveries to various hospitals. Just set one up today for Parklands and Derry. And so we're really encouraged about that. I think over 6,000 pieces have been donated. We got a list developed from the Hospital Association of essential items that the healthcare workers are looking for to support them at this time, as well as words of encouragement and support, which in conversations with the various healthcare officials, they particularly appreciate. If you read the news right now, you know, not only are they dealing with the physical and emotional toll of coronavirus, but hospitals are hurting in New Hampshire right now. They're losing a lot of money. A lot of healthcare workers have been furloughed or lost their jobs. And so this is a timely effort that's ongoing, supporting the hospitals. I want to encourage anyone who's interested to reach out to Derek or Eric Ouellette, who's been the point of contact at the council to set these up. And I'll work with you to make that contact at your hospital Obviously, we're cognizant of social distancing guidelines. We've had a few units express concern about, getting too close or otherwise. And so the hospitals are very versed in how to deal with this, as is the council. And we've been able to successfully and safely make these deliveries, which has gotten great media coverage. WMUR covered the launch of this initiative. We've had it on local radio in a couple of different places. Newspapers have picked it up. And now social media is picking up. Joe Pepe, the CEO of Catholic Medical Center, posted a great social media post about a visit he had from some scouts recently making a delivery. And so obviously we want to do good for the hospitals and our healthcare workers. And it's also a great opportunity to have scouts be front and center at this very difficult time. So in any event, we're very encouraged. And I would say the next 2 weeks remain critical. COVID cases remain, new cases are being reported every day at a very significant level. And so the need is still there, according to our contacts at the Hospital Association. So again, if you're interested, I encourage you to reach out to Derek and Eric, and I'll coordinate with them to facilitate a smooth delivery.
Great, Jim. Thank you. We really appreciate your leadership and guidance through putting the good turn together for us. So thanks a lot for everything you're doing to help us out there. And I hope everyone can engage with us to do our best for the hospitals. Next on our agenda is something that I'm really excited about, and it's our new DWC information app. And here to talk with us a little bit more about that is Tyler Yankee, who is our field director and our marketing and communication specialist. Tyler, can you tell us about the app?
Yeah, thanks, Derek. Pretty excited about some new opportunities coming in 2020 to support our families and our unit volunteers on getting up-to-date information about Daniel Webster Council, what's happening in their district, and even expanding on into features like push notifications. So we're appreciative of generosity of one of our volunteers and donors that has helped us with creating a mechanism to build an app on iOS and Android devices. It's even available in the web as well as on tablets. And that'll be rolling out in the next couple of weeks. About the end of May, we're finalizing our 2020-2021 program planning guide. And this will be the main source of information that we deliver into the information app. One of these added features is it'll give our volunteers the opportunity at a district level to update their information in real time for their upcoming events and in the ability to send out push notifications if roundtables or other activities are canceled. What you're seeing on your screen now is a little snippet, a preview of what the app looks like. It's ran in a system called Event Truly. It gives us the opportunity to really showcase a variety of things in a one-stop shop location. What you see now on your screen is kind of the main navigation. And then it'll pop into, we did a screenshot of the calendar that Derek will jump to next. This will show, for example, if you were to access the calendar in the app on a given date, what all those activities would be listed for that date. And then if you were to click on the activity, you would get more information as well. It breaks down into district level, council level, and what you see here is an example of activity review at a district level. So Arrowhead District here is our case study that shows here are the activities that are upcoming. If you were to click on one, it would expand out and give you a little bit more information, who to contact, et cetera. It's a cool feature for volunteers too at the district level, where we'll be able to give them access that they can update the information there and then update the council calendar as well. Unfortunately, the mechanics do not combine together, so they are two separate pieces of updates, but we will be rolling out this feature as well as the 2020-2021 program planning guide in a downloadable PDF in this digital format here at the end of May. Derek, I believe that is all on the app. I'm willing to take questions if they pop in, but right now I think we are ready to go.
Sounds good. Thanks, Tyler. I'm excited to have that out and working. I think it's a great tool for us to be able to share information with everyone. So great work with you and Tom and Zynga putting that together. So thanks so much for working on that. Next, we have Bria Rico, who will give us an update about the EVOA.
Thank you, Derek. So the EVOA is closing out its first term. So first, I want to congratulate and thank our current panel of officers that we've had. For those who are not aware, our current president, Elizabeth, is now going to be the president on the area level. And we are very excited for her. If you would like to take up the torch from the 2019-2020 term, our applications are found on our Instagram, which is DWCEVOA. And also we've been sharing it on our Facebook, and it's also on the council website. If you go to the council website, search EVOA, that'll bring you to our page, and it's under forms and resources. So that application, we are still taking them until May 1st. And as part of the EVOA, and even just as a general venturer or exploring scout, there are some fun things you can do, like following us on our social media pages as a great way to stay in contact with us. And also, we have been doing and preparing not just online programs. We've hosted a couple of Kahoots. We will be hosting some more in the future. But mark your calendars, because Moot 2020 is indeed returning to Hidden Valley for October 10th and 11th. Again, that was October 10th and 11th. And finally, at this time, Venturing Fest, while they are monitoring the situation day to day, they are still planning on holding Venturing Fest 2020. And again, this was the Exploring Venturing Officers Association update for you. And we are very excited to see who will pick up the torch next year. Thanks, Derek.
Hey, Derek, we had a question come in for Brianna. From the audience, they're looking to know what EVOA stands for.
That is the Exploring Venturing Officers Association. So this Officers Association, you can be an Exploring Scout, you can be a Venturing Scout, you can be both. But we like to try and do programs for both types of programs. And one initiative is we want to bring the exploring program more into the fold. So certainly if you are in the exploring program or even the venturing program, we would love to have your application to be part of our team to serve your local scouts.
Perfect. Great. Thanks, Brianna. Looking forward to some more great stuff coming from the EVOA as we get into the fall and some programming. So thanks a lot for all of that. As we shift gears here, we have coming up some information about summer camp, and I'd like to introduce Phil Donovan, who is our camping chairman for the council, to talk to us a little bit about some of the planning that's going on in the challenging time here of getting ready for summer camp 2020. So Phil, can you give us some updates?
Love to, Derek. Thank you. And good evening to everybody tonight. Hope this this time is not getting you down. So we're going to talk about something good tonight, and that is camping. And I know that you probably have a lot of questions about camping, and so do we. There are more questions than answers, I think, on everybody's part. But we'll try to answer a couple of them tonight. But if you do have a question that I don't touch on, in this brief time that we have. Feel free to put something into the Q&A, and Matt and I will try to answer those questions during the course of the night. And if we don't get to it tonight, you can always drop a note to camping@nhscouting.org, and somebody will get back to you with an answer. But let me give you a high-level overview of what's going on in camping. We have looked at what our summer is going to look like in view of the current coronavirus situation. And we don't know exactly when things are going to change for us. So we've been putting together alternative plans. And we really looked at the summer in kind of three broad ways. One, with thinking that there would be no change in plans. The other extreme is, you know, we wouldn't have a camping season this summer. And somewhere in the middle is that our season might be shortened a bit. So right now, we have made the decision to shorten the season by really eliminating the first 2 weeks of summer camp. That's where we are at this point. The reason for that is there's a number of them, but we figured that by shortening the season, it gives us an extra 2 weeks to make arrangements, make sure that the staff is trained properly for any procedures that we have to do to make sure that the camp is safe, get everybody trained up, and really just make sure that we're ready to open camp. So right now, camp is scheduled to open on July 5th, Sunday, July 5th. So we will have 6 weeks of camp at GSR, and really 5 weeks right now at Camp Carpenter. So everything will start a little bit late. One thing that does is it changes at Camp Bell, it changes the NYLT week from week one. We're now gonna put that into week eight at Camp Bell. So that will be the last week of camp instead of the first week of camp. Everyone who's affected by this change should have been notified so far, at least notified. We've asked those people who are affected by it, those units who are affected by this change, to think about when a better time for them would be to reschedule into the existing weeks of camp. So that process is ongoing right now. So the first 2 weeks of camp, any units that were scheduled to do those 2 weeks are being rescheduled into the remainder weeks. So that is an ongoing process. In the slight possibility that we miss somebody, if you're listening tonight, please get in touch with us right away. I don't think we've missed anybody at either end of those weeks though. So everybody has been notified, although we're still in the process of making sure that we can squeeze everybody into the other weeks. We're hoping to pull off camp. We will be following the guidelines set forth federally, statewide, and locally to make sure that camp is safe and fun for everybody. There are some challenges that we're taking a look at, it's a little bit premature to say exactly what might be affected in terms of programming or just everyday normal life at camp, but I think it's safe to say that it might be a little bit different. So we're hoping that everybody looks at this as an opportunity to change things up a little bit and have some fun with it. And we want to get kids into camp and give them that experience because we know how valuable that is. We will keep everybody updated as we need to and as we know more. So, but in the meantime, again, if you have any questions particular to your unit, please let us know and we'll try to take those kinds of things on a case-by-case basis. A couple of other things, camperships. We've extended out camperships to June 1st, so we'll accept applications for camperships right up until June 1st. Please get them in as early as you can, though. Don't wait till June 1st, like we normally do as scouters. Let's see if we can get those in. If you need an application, you can go to the council website and look for an application there. So just visit the website and get those campership applications. Let's see. We've got a couple other things I wanted to touch on. We've been having camp promotions. We did some virtual camp promotions. If you didn't get a chance to see them, they are available somewhere. I'm not sure where. Matt might be able to put that into the chat room. I think those are available. I know that on Saturday evenings, some of the camp directors and program directors get together and do some live presentations, you know, so you can get to ask them questions on Saturday evenings. And there is some Cub Scout program webinars coming up, and probably you may have gotten an email about those, but those are held every couple of days. We just had one on April 26th. The next one is May 3rd at 4 p.m. So look for that in the Cub Scout camping area. We want to hold as much as possible to camp payment dates. So May 15th is still a valid date for full payment. I know that there's people coming and going because of the unknowns, but we want to see if we can pull in as many of those final payments as possible by May 15th, because that just helps us logistically, and it takes some of that work off the table for later on. You know, anybody who is signing up still for summer camp can still get the early bird rate. So we're going to hold that early bird rate for a while to see, so that we can make sure we get as many kids into camp as we possibly can. So, but at any rate, payments need to be made prior to the arrival at camp. Okay. So we want to stick to those dates as much as possible for planning purposes, so we know how many people we're actually going to have in camp, and it helps us with all kinds of logistical issues. So your cooperation is appreciated there. I think I've touched on pretty much everything I have in a general way. Again, if you have questions that I didn't touch on, go ahead and write those questions and answers, and then if we don't catch it tonight, you can certainly always reach us at camping@nhscouting.org. So with that, I think that I will turn that back over to Derek, if there's nothing else.
Great. Thanks, Phil. Derek, before we move on, we do have some questions here in the chat. One's from Christopher Kahn and Melissa Woods that I'll be able to address as regarding Den Chief overnight training. If this is the Camp Carpenter specific Den Chief overnight training, that's scheduled for June 6th through the 7th. That information can be found at nhscouting.org/Cub Scout Camping. So that information can be found there, as well as on the Camp Carpenter Facebook page and website. A couple others regarding NYLT. If the scouts for NYLT have been notified about the change for their week of course.
The participants may not have been notified about that yet. I'm not sure. Maybe I think Matt is on. Maybe he can help me with that. But I don't think the participants have been notified yet.
Phil, that is correct. We are working. We have an email going out to all the participants, so they will be notified within the next.
So it seems Matt's audio cut out there. The NYLT participants are in the process of being notified. We started those camp notifications for the first two weeks of camp last Friday into today. So we're continuing to carry those out, and those participants will be notified soon. Questions regarding Part C of the medical form? Updates on Part C will be continued to address through guidance provided by the state and the BSA. The BSA medical form requirements are part of the standardization and accreditation program, so we're working through the national office to address medical form requirements. Some program questions came in, one being, for scouts that are unable to maybe attend summer camp this season because of health conditions. Has there been any thought in providing some virtual options for them to still experience camp, but maybe from home, but still have that camp environment?
Tyler, I'll take that question if Phil doesn't mind. We are Thanks, Phil. We are working on some alternatives in case, you know, for those situations. They're not quite fleshed out, but I do know we have a variety of online merit badges that are already in place and have been worked on through some of our volunteers. So, and I believe we are going to be having some more of those through the summer too as well.
Great, thanks, Matt. Appreciate that. Some questions came up about social distancing and staffing. If people have specific questions, who should they contact or email with those questions to address them individually? For example, if they have members, other unit whose families just aren't comfortable maybe going to summer camp this year. So as it relates to health standards for camp and COVID-19, who should people reach out to get those addressed?
I think they really should be reaching that out to the camping department at camping at nhscouting.org. That'd be the best places to get those answers mm-hmm. regarding the overall, you know, questions about, you know, how we're handling some of the COVID-19 updates. Just as if we are still working those out, so that is part of the reason why we are adjusting our weeks of camp. So we may not have a right answer right away, but for the most part, we're still working on those as we speak. And as far as communication about whether or not leaders or scouts are comfortable or just want to get more details, again, they can contact the camping department for those questions. If they have a direct line to me or even Mark Campbell for the Cub people, we either one of us should be able to answer those questions relatively quickly.
Great. Thanks, Matt. Appreciate that. And then I believe that covers camping questions for now. If I miss somebody in the Q&A, we'll return to that before the presentation ends.
Life has us keeping our distance, but there's never been a more important time to come together. Scouting looks a little different than what we're used to, sure, but across the country, scouts are coming together to learn, grow, and serve even while apart, because that's what scouting has always been about. Yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Our culture is one of perseverance and determination. Our foundation is that of always being prepared. When you think about it, we've been preparing for times like these for over 100 years. Because for the past century, we've been pioneers, adventurers, helpers, scouts. Nothing can stop us. We've got this. We are scouts.
Scouting certainly does look a little different right now, but DWC units have been very active during this time of social distancing. A few of our leaders, staff, and volunteers are going to share some of their ideas, best practices, and upcoming activities. To join us now from PAC-75 Bow is Vic Carboneau, who is the Cub Master. He's going to share with us a little bit about the virtual family camp out that happened just this weekend. And also a little bit more about some of the other activities that PAC-75 is doing. Vic?
Hi, thanks. So we had a virtual camp out. It started off kind of as a smaller event. We were doing it for us And we opened it up to the town because the kids in town and the school district was actually looking for something to help keep all the kids entertained. You know, and it was all an online program. So we said, hey, why not? We also reached out to Pac-184, who was creating a lot of video content. I'm sure some of you have seen it. They sent over some stuff. And slowly it kind of grew from there. And a lot of people wound up participating. We actually had some people come in. I think the farthest one I saw post on the Facebook page was actually in Oklahoma. But we had PACs all over the state. In fact, I think I've seen some of the names. Some of you guys were there and everything. And it was a lot of fun. I saw lots of pictures of smiley, happy people. The way we did it, if you weren't there, it was pretty easy. We had a lot of great leaders putting together videos. We put them into YouTube playlists. And then we sent out a Google document with the links to those videos or those playlists, which made the families were able to adjust that to their own schedule so that they could, you know, if their kids were younger and needed to go to bed earlier, they could play all this stuff earlier and have an early campfire program. If they're later, older, they could stay up later or whatever. Kind of made it really easy for everybody. We're also doing some online PAC meetings. And one of the other fun things we do is our school district is sending out a morning announcements to the kids at home. And in the morning announcements, the vice principal's been doing the Pledge of Allegiance. And we reached out and they said, yeah, we'd love to see the Cub Scouts doing it and everything. So the kids get to see other kids in uniform doing the Pledge of Allegiance for the whole school, which has been kind of fun. So that's a lot of what we got going on.
Thanks, Vic. That's some great stuff. Appreciate you sharing what's going on and with PAC 75. And I'd encourage others, if you have ideas, to certainly share those in the chat or on social media on the Daniel Webster Council Facebook page, so we can all learn from the experiences that you're having. Next, I'd like to ask Skip Chase if you could share with us some of the things that your program group has been working on for virtual Cub Scout programming.
Absolutely, Derek. The Camp Carpenter staff, Mark Hamill and his crowd, have been doing a lot of videos online. They've been posting them on Facebook. We're going to work on bringing some of that content to the Scouting at Home page so that Cub Scouts and their families can see what's going on at summer camp. There's activities, there's fun songs, all kinds of things that they'll be doing. We still have on the calendar Spring Fling for Memorial Day weekend, although we've already made it just a day event, but we don't have the final details together. But we're also taking a look at making that a virtual event, and we're also working on other virtual events for Cub Scouts through the Camp Carpenter staff in lieu of summer camp, if that is something that we have to do. So we're working hard on that. We also have Steve Hamilton, the ranger there, has made a video and has several more. We'll be getting those up this week as well. And then we also want to support our Cub Scout dens, especially helping them to get their advancement done. We're going to add a little bit of advancement work. Because there is so much out there, it's very hard for us to do it all. But we can help out in individual cases and put things up as well. If you or your PAC has been doing videos and things like that and want to get involved, feel free to contact me at skip.chase@scouting.org, and we'll work on getting that content up. We know Vic and PAC 75 and Bo, Paul Harriman, PAC 184, I think that's Dover area. Those two have done a tremendous amount of work, and there's some other PACs that are starting to do that. So we'd like to get as many people involved in that virtual programming. And I'll pass it back to Derek.
Thanks, Skip. Appreciate it. Some good programming coming along. Good stuff. Next, Peter Rowe from Troop 6G has been doing some great things, engaging with the girls in the troop. And Peter, we'd like you to share some of the things that Troop 6 is doing.
Hey, great. Yes. I just wanted to sort of make the point that, you know, everybody knows this is not the optimal way to do scouting. Scouting is an outdoor thing, and we're pretty much all stuck in our houses. The most important thing you can be doing for your scouts right now is holding their interest, keeping things fun, keeping it so that they want to come back. So we did a virtual camp out, and every scout was in their own backyard. Scouts who needed equipment, we were able to do what's called a dead drop, where we leave it, and the scout comes out and picks it up, and there's no contact, so there's not really a risk of transmitting disease. They ended up getting on Zoom and talking for a couple of hours, just having fun back and forth. And then they got onto Scribble.io and played that until 12:30 in the morning. And then they all went to bed. You have the option to do a lot of the same things that you would do on a regular camp out with just a little bit of a change in how you do it. So the particular picture that's up right now, that's my 40-year-old tent that finally gave up one of its tie downs. And so we repaired it using a sheet bend and a taut line hitch. Just by annotating these pictures and sending it out on email, it's a very easy way to have that teachable moment that we would have had on a real camp out while we had a virtual camp out. Next up on the slides, you can get your kids involved with quizzes. So Scouting Magazine has a number of pre-prepared quizzes. Boys Life has a number of pre-prepared quizzes, and you can just bring these right up into your meeting and take the quiz. And it generates a lot of back and forth with the scouts as they talk about, you know, what the right answer is and argue with each other. And I've had one scout who's lost several million-dollar bets as to what the correct answer is, and it really keeps them engaged. The nice thing about these too is the content is pre-vetted because these are scout sites that are doing this. If you have a little bit of internet knowledge, you can actually suck the, in the next slide, you can suck the thing out and make it bigger. Makes it easier for you people to see it. Next up is Kahoot.com, which is a great way to do quizzes online because it's very interactive. And I've got a couple of slides that take you through it. This is sort of a demo of what shows on the screen and then what shows on the app. And you can see the players come in, make themselves a nickname, and then you get asked questions such as who founded the Boy Scouts of America. And then you get an answer that in this case turns out to be sort of wrong because Baden-Powell formed Boy Scouts in general, which is one of the things you have to be careful with Kahoot is that sometimes it's not always right, and you may want to vet the questions and answers before you put them up yourself. Next up, they played Scribble.io, which is basically an online version of Pictionary. Make sure if you do this that you get a private room. You'll then have to send out a link so that everyone can be in that private room. You don't want to have this as a public event because you can get all sorts of untoward things. So you can put custom words in, and you can use those exclusively or in addition to words that it generates. You can see the link down in the bottom that you'll have to pass on to your scouts as they do this. Then you start up the game and the drawing starts. So here we choose the word Pepsi, and because I'm just absolutely terrible at drawing, my drawing was just the Pepsi logo, and my daughter had no difficulty guessing that one. You get points for time, both for the person who's drawing and for the person who's guessing. It really, really keeps them engaged. It keeps everything fun. Something that we wanted to bring up too, just briefly, is Zoom security. And I could do a whole seminar on nothing but Zoom security, so I'm not going to because that's too long. But we did put together a white paper that talks a little bit about the security issues in detail. So if you have parents asking questions about why is it good enough for my kid but not good enough for Congress, you can answer those questions. And then the last page of it is a very quick and easy sheet on which buttons to click to set your Zoom up to be more secure than the way it comes out of the box. I think that covers all the points I wanted to hit. If there's any questions.
Very good, thanks Peter, appreciate it. We also have CJ Byrne, who is doing some great things with his troop as well. So CJ, would you like to share some things that are going on?
Sure, I wanted to start out by saying how impressed I was with our SPL for really kind of taking up the charge to keep the kids engaged. So when everything started to get shut down, I would suspect that a good portion of us on this call had, you know, had maybe used Zoom or maybe used GoToMeeting once in a while. And now here we are a month later and we're all becoming experts rapidly because these tools are becoming so quickly used. But the kids are so well-versed in these things already that within a week of shutting down, my SPL reached out to me and said, Mr. Bourne, we need to sort of get everybody connected and keep going. We got to figure out how to make this work. So I was really, really pleased with them. We started with getting our PLCs running online and then started doing some virtual meetings online. I was just looking back in our calendar and really we missed one meeting so far with the crisis. After that, we started again with PLCs and we said, why don't we take advantage of some of this downtime? So we pulled in our calendar planning sessions and got those going. And of course, we jumped right into game design. So at the troop level, doing game design merit badge is perfect right now, because you can really jump in any one of these games, and some of these sites even let you sort of design your own, and that is a perfect avenue to work on the merit badge. So the boys have been playing Scribble.io, much like Peter just showed. They've been doing Minecraft. They did a round on Roblox, which my youngest son, who's now 15, hasn't played in like 5 years. But not only did they play and have a blast that night, but they set themselves up to do a patrol meeting the next night and do it again. So it's kind of funny. I've been after them to get more patrol meetings going in general. And here we are locked in our houses and they're happy to do a patrol meeting virtually. So I would be shocked if even after things sort of start to get back to a little bit of normal, we can meet again, that they will likely probably keep one meeting a month online as it is, and use this avenue to try different things out that they wouldn't have necessarily been able to try, because we're always taking all the electronics away. So I think it's a learning lesson for us as well, that there is a place to the electronics. We got to figure out how to make it work and expand our horizons in scouting. So it's been exciting. I'm happy to see the scouting spirit moving forward, and the boys are certainly in 15 are trying to have fun.
Thanks, CJ and Peter. Some really great points for us to take away there, and really appreciate you guys sharing some of the best practices that you've uncovered throughout the last several weeks. So thanks again for doing that. Next is Ben Dibble, who's the Activities Committee Chair for the Arrowhead District, and Ben and his committee are working really hard on a virtual spring camporee. And he's here to tell us a little bit more about what they have in store and what the planning is. Ben?
Okay, unmute. Hi, everybody. There we are. Hopefully you can see the PDF that I have up here. First of all, there's my name and email address and phone number. This is in case somebody needs to get a hold of me later to ask questions about this. This is a work in progress. I've had 3 meetings with senior patrol leaders and presidents in Arrowhead District. They are putting this together with some guidance from the Scoutmasters and myself. And so this is something that we've come up with so far. Let me start going through it a little bit. First of all, it's going to be a multi-week activity. We're going to start May 15th at 7 p.m. with an opening online campfire, an on-fire. We're still working on the plans for that. Then we're going to have, 2 days later, we're going to have a SPL, SM Cracker Barrel to see how things are going, because they will have had 2 days to start working on the games and activities. Then they'll have 2 weeks to complete the events and challenges. They're getting a midweek Cracker Barrel on the 29th. The games are going to close. So that's basically a couple of weeks here, the last 2 weeks or so in May. And they're going to, and finally on May 31st, we're going to have a closing campfire from 7 to 8:30. Hopefully that'll all work out. Here's what the scouts came up with for games and challenges. There's a combination of some are just patrol within the patrol. Some are inter-patrol, two patrols from two different troops. And there are some optionals, there's some required. It's almost like a merit badge. So we've got a Jeopardy game that one of the scouts, Emma, came up with, and we're going to be running that patrol versus patrol. So we're going to have to talk to the patrol leaders and find out when they can have a daytime they can get together, and we'll try to match up some patrols to play. We're going to do an escape room. That'll be patrol teamwork against a clock, not against each other. And then there's a list of activities the patrol can choose one or one from the list. They can do cooking. Cooking has been a bit of a challenge because they say, hey, how about we make some bread? Well, the yeast is all sold, so you can't do that. So we've come up with this is my proposal to the scouts. They all cook something, and they do before and after photos, and they get points awarded for creativity challenge in the presentation. Or the patrol may choose to do exercising. They might want to do the tenderfoot exercises or do like a 3K walk in the area. And there's there's some online apps that are available to track their hiking so they can see where they went. We do want a little bit of accountability to see how they accomplished what they're doing. Maybe the patrol decides to do some tree leaf animal ID, and they can use the 2 weeks to do that, see if they can get the most leaves, the most trees, the most animals, the most bushes. Camping as a patrol, camping in your backyard, living room, or wherever. The only requirement is you cannot sleep in a bed. You can sleep in a cot. You can sleep in a hammock. You can sleep in a pillow fort. You can sleep on the couch, but not a pullout couch. And that seemed like for the scouts that are in apartments that can't get out, scouts that cannot reach, they don't have tents at home, they cannot reach the tents. A dead drop would be nice. But I was continuing to get some pushback, so I came up with this as an idea. A service project. This is one of the required activities. As a patrol, figure out a way to do a service project to help another person or group. They can make thank you notes. They can do PSA, all sorts of stuff. I'm not really picky on what they do. Just wanted to get out there and do something. And finally, an optional activity, do a virtual patrol flag or a song skit for the final campfire. Or a meme, do something along those lines. And so this is what we've put together so far to try to get the scouts, give them something different and unusual to do during this time and still work towards some scout skills and activities. Any questions over there? We got an e-prep question in there, or the e-prep comment. So I guess I'll throw it back to Derek.
Great, Ben. Thanks a lot. Sounds pretty exciting. I may have to find some patrol mates so that I can participate in the camporee with you guys. So sounds like fun coming up. Colin Butler has been leading a group of people throughout the council, some staff and volunteers alike, putting together some program opportunities for Scouts BSA. So I'd like Colin to talk a little bit about some of the Scouts BSA virtual programs and speakers programs that are upcoming and that are being planned. Colin?
Yeah, sure. More than happy to. So hi, everyone. Thanks for joining. So at the outset, many of you, I'm sure, who are on this call probably received an email some time ago with a program update from the council. One of the virtual programs that the council is offering includes an online merit badge series. At this point, we have approximately bit over a dozen, I think the number right now is about 17 merit badges that are currently listed on the website. Not all of those have registrations up and running, frankly, because we need volunteers. We have volunteers who have committed to staff the program, but also need to find the time in their schedules to commit to the youth. So with that being said, there'll be continual updates to those. We're constantly looking for more merit badge counselors and volunteers to help us out. There's a merit badge counselor interest survey directly on nhscouting.org. You could even Google it. If you Google NH Scouting merit badge counselor survey, The first thing that pops up, I just tried it. The first thing that pops up is a link to that survey. We have a pretty quick and easy onboarding process to get you all familiar, or whoever the volunteer is, familiar with video conferencing, whether it's through Zoom or another interface such as Google Meets, so that we can have that face-to-face between the youth and their merit badge counselor. And then also through Google Classroom, which is the platform that we're using to track progress through the requirements. So anyway, there's more to come on that. There are some merit badges already up there. There's others that'll be coming. And actually this evening on my to-do list is to draft up some new registrations, including aviation merit badge, amongst others. So that's exciting and soon to come. But again, we're constantly looking for volunteers and support in that program area. On to the Speakers Bureau. So the council has identified some individuals who would be more than happy to speak to our scouts and offer some expert insight and exposure to interesting areas of their life. So far we've had three speakers, one of which was a former Brigadier General, a retired Brigadier General of the Air Force, who's also a doctor. He was a military attaché in Beijing and had a lot of timely sort of insight into what's going on with COVID and so forth. So that was a great event. We have some others coming. Stay tuned to that. Excuse me. Lastly, what I would say is that we're working to build some STEM virtual programming. The challenge here really is volunteer support and having expertise to deliver the time and expertise to deliver the program. I've had about three different brainstorming sessions with sets of volunteers to discuss what online STEM programming would look like, how we could run experiments with kids over Zoom, but using common household items, using guided discovery to ask kids questions and have them engage with all kinds of different material, whether it's the four forces of flight or how different chemicals react using things in your kitchen, or refracting of light, right? If we take water in a glass and see how words look through the glass with water and without it, things like this. So anyway, if anyone has any other thoughts, ideas, questions, comments, I'm more than happy to take them. And you're also more than welcome to email me at colin.butler@scouting.org. My email address is all over the website. I'm sure it can be populated in the chat here. So.
Very good.
Derek, we did get a question. The question's for Ben from Gary Crane, asking if the virtual campery is open for the entire council.
At this time, I'd like to keep it closed to just Arrowhead, just to make sure that we don't overstep and bite off more than we can chew. I want to make sure that this thing works before we roll it out. Be happy to tell everybody how it goes, and you can learn from our mistakes. Hopefully no mistakes at all.
Great, thanks, Ben. Derek, that's the questions as it relates to program. We do have some additional camping questions here at the end, but we're ready for advancement.
Great. So thanks again, Colin and Ben, for your Scouts BSA programming items. Next, we have Ed Parsons, who's our council advancement chair, and he's going to give us some updates on advancement in our time of social distancing and COVID-19. Ed?
Thank you, Derek. If you could put that slide up with the URL for the Scouting at Home advancement, that would be helpful. So everything I'm going to talk about is already on a web page, and you can see there that URL, coronavirus/COVID-19 FAQ. That's the place to go, but I did want to mention a few specific items on there of import. So for example, those of you who have Weeblo Scouts, question is, how do you move forward with advancement if generally Weeblo should be signed off by some sort of leader in the unit? Well, during this time and up through July 31st, parents and other adults in the Cub Scouts family may sign off on Weeblo's and Arrow of Light requirements. So the criteria has been loosened a little bit with respect to who can sign off for the Weeblos. And also during this time, We strongly encourage that parents use the Scouting app or Scout book to record completion of their child's requirements. No more paper. Let's use our app, and they run on Android and iPhone and on PC. Moving up to Scouts BSA and Venturing, in terms of rank advancement, again, going to that URL, I strongly urge everyone to go there and read through it. But picking a few items from that, advancement can continue to the extent it can be done virtually through this period of the restrictions. For example, virtual visits to a city council meeting, a natural historic landmark, or museum is perfectly acceptable. But for example, some things may not work out during this period of restrictions, like how to meet the swimming requirement or hiking merit badge, rifle shooting, so forth. Those cannot be completed virtually, entirely virtually for sure, but some may be able to do part of it. Those need to wait. If you're going to hold a virtual campout to meet requirements, all virtual campouts and activities should consist of as many elements found on a normal outdoor campout or activity as possible. The most significant difference is that patrol or troop members are not allowed to be in the same location, but other elements certainly can occur in a virtual campout, and that's another way of meeting the camping requirements. On that FAQ webpage, you will also find some modifications to requirements for tenderfoot, second class, and first class. There's about a dozen modifications for each one. So if you've got scouts working on those ranks, there's some modifications that National has allowed for those specific requirements. So I'm not going to go through them. I just want to refer to them. How about eagles? Eagle boards are still happening during this time. They're happening virtually, just like through the Zoom meeting. Each district runs their own eagle board, and each district's eagle board is handling their video conferencing slightly differently. Most of them are using an app like this, Zoom, but they're all doing video conferencing for their eagle boards. They're still happening, both for the project approvals and the final eagle boards. How about Life Scouts working on Eagle, but turning 18 during this period of restrictions? They're not necessarily getting enough time to work on their projects. What do? They're running out of time. During this period of the restrictions, only through September 30th, National has allowed the Council Advancement Committees to grant limited Eagle extensions for those Life Scouts working on Eagle who are unable to finish requirements due to the restrictions of COVID-19. So if you have Life Scouts working on Eagle who are running into problems because they can't finish their project, and it's not surprising, please have them submit a request for an extension. Those could be sent electronically, like a letter from the scout, a parent, or a unit leader to Skip Chase, skip.chase@scouting.org, and he'll send them to me, and we'll get them taken care of. Our advancement committee meets every month, and we go through the Eagle extensions. We've already done over a dozen of them, and we've got a bunch more to do in May. And we do about, we always look out about 30 days. So if you've got somebody with a birthday in August who's worried about it, we're not going to cover that case yet. We only do about the next 30 days out at a time, as far as Eagles. And that, those are the highlights. Again, please go to that URL to get other questions answered. Thank you.
Great, thanks, Ed. Derek, before we move on, we do have some questions that came up in the Q&A. A couple things that have come up in the chat as well before we get to the questions. We are going to send out a follow-up email with the slide deck, a copy, a link for you to be able to watch this video on demand, and all the resources and links in the next day or two. So stay tuned for that. You will get additional information and all the handouts that were presented today. Questions are for the camping committee. Couple questions here for both Matt and Phil. First is regarding day camps. Are there any effects on day camps around the state, particularly the ones that are starting at the beginning of the season in June, and the impact of day camps at like a YMCA or another public venue?
Sorry. The Seacoast YMCA day camp right now is the only one that is directly affected. We are in the works of trying to reschedule that one in particular. Seacoast YMCA itself is very willing to work with us, and that's what we're trying to do is secure those dates now. When we do have that information, we will contact all those who have already registered and let them know what the new changes are. As far as any other day camps, I do not believe it has any other effects, except for the ones that the day camp that is being held at Camp Carpenter specifically. Those folks have been notified already and have been asked to either look at the other day camp at Carpenter week that is coming up later in the month in July, or to take a look at the other day camps around the state. But those are the only two day camps that are affected.
Great, thanks. Question regarding camp staffing. Who should they contact for follow-up on their applications through the hiring process for camp staff this summer?
Yep, they can email camping@nhscouting.org. That will get to myself and Val directly. And for the most part, those questions come to me anyways. So even if you have my email address, you can do that as well.
Great. Question came up regarding payment deadlines for summer camp. Specifically, are there any penalties if a unit has to pay the remaining portion of their summer camp fees after May 15th?
There are no penalty fees after May 15th. We are asking all of our units and scouts and families to do a hold to the May 15th payment date, specifically for those who are already making the commitments to go to camp. If you have scouts and families that are still working on fundraising and things of that nature and need more time, obviously we're trying to work with all of our units to help do that in a timely fashion. But it is important that we try to have as much as your unit payments made in on the timeline as much as possible.
Great, thanks, Matt. Two last ones here. One is, well, camp properties, or what's the plan for reopening camp properties on the 15th of May? Is there any update there?
Right now, I would say the best update we can give is that we're waiting and listening to what the governor has to say regarding to opening up the state. Right now, the timeline is the 15th to have that decision made by. So I would just hang tight until we know officially what our plans are.
Great. Question here, just a reminder on the campership application. What is the new due date for the campership application?
Yeah. Campership applications should be mailed in to the council office. By June 1st.
Great. So camperships are due by June 1st. They were extended out a little bit to give families more of an opportunity to go through that process. And they are fillable PDFs, so e-signatures or written approval from the volunteer probably would suffice for that final signature needed from the unit leader. Defer here to our lodge advisor, staff advisor from the Order of the Arrow. Question came in if there's any idea on rescheduling the spring ordeal. Or will there be only an opportunity for those elected at the fall ordeal weekends? Thomas, we'll get you the answer to your question and I'll follow up and type it into the text box to the question you asked. And we'll go over that here shortly. With that, I kick it back to you, Derek.
Thanks, Tyler. Appreciate it. Next up, we have Chris Cooper, who is the Daniel Webster Council Friends of Scouting Chair, and has done some great things revamping our Friends of Scouting program this year. So here to tell us a little more about a new crowdfunding option that we have to help your unit reach their 2020 Family Friends of Scouting goals. Chris Cooper. Chris?
All right, great. Thank you, Derek. You know, we've had kind of a tale of two different Friends of Scouting campaigns this year. The first half of the Friends of Scouting campaign period was really going gangbusters. We were on track to meet or even exceed our Friends of Scouting goals, and there was a lot of enthusiasm among units around the state, around the council, that had their Friends of Scouting presentations already. Obviously, at this point, there are a number of units out there who weren't able to have their Friends of Scouting presentation before meetings got switched over to a virtual setting. So we want to make sure that we have the ability to reach out to each of those units and the families in those units to give them the opportunity to still contribute to Friends of Scouting. With that said, I mean, there's still a real need for the Friends of Scouting contributions right now. We obviously know that it could be a difficult time for some families to give as people's work situations maybe curtailed or shortened or maybe furloughed or out of work completely. So we understand that there's a range of circumstances facing your families, but for those who can or those who might want to give later in the year, we still want to make sure that they have the opportunity to be reached, or for those of us who do still have the ability to give, that we can make those gifts. You've seen tonight that the council staff has been very busy. You know, we're still planning for summer camp. We've got people working on all kinds of things to give us the kind of resources that we need as volunteers to be able to provide quality programming to our units. And so we do still need that help. So with that said, we're launching a kind of a two-prong virtual Friends of Scouting campaign to kind of finish off the spring FOS season. The first part of that is to ask unit leaders from those units who haven't yet had a presentation to forward a prepared email to their families and leaders. Each of those units has an online fundraising page set up for them. So families from those units can go straight to that URL that will be shared in those emails and click to get to the website where they can make a donation to the Friends of Scouting campaign. Donations made that way will get credited to their unit and then therefore to their district as well, so that we can keep track of units and districts and help them all reach their goals and reach the various incentives that we have available for families and for units. The second prong is that we're asking committee chairs to help us out and to try kind of a new strategy of expanding the reach of our Friends of Scouting effort. So instead of just talking to the families that come to a unit meeting, whether that's a blue and gold or a court of honor that we normally do, we want to reach out to a wider range or a wider audience to include extended family or friends or colleagues or alumni from, you know, scouts who have since moved on and become adults and are out in the world, but may not yet have kids in the program and may not be connected straight away to us. So committee chairs are going to get an email with a link that they can share, or they can simply text the word help scouts. And this is true for any of you right now. You can text the word help scouts to 71777. And with that text message, you'll get an invitation to become a fundraiser. You can select your troop. If your troop isn't in the drop-down option, maybe you've already had your presentation. We can get that added very easily. You can contact the development staff or myself, and we can get that added. And then that way you can make social media posts and extend this fundraising campaign out to all of your contacts and ask them to help support scouting in New Hampshire and help your unit reach its goal and help continue to provide the kind of programming resources that we need to make sure that this is a successful year of scouting. Just because we're not able to meet in person doesn't mean that scouting isn't happening. And for that scouting to happen, we still do need the resources to make it work. And so we're counting on everybody to all chip in. And we really appreciate the first few who have helped us pilot this and are really looking forward to a lot of people jumping on this bandwagon and making this a successful conclusion to our 2020 FOS campaign. And, you know, if you have any questions, I'm always available to provide answers. And if I don't know them, I can find them out. Or you can reach out to Eric Willette or to John Rainville at the council office. They're still on email and answering phone calls. So any of the three of us can help you out. And with that, I'll toss it back to you.
Great, thanks, Chris. Appreciate it. Really excited that we have a few units that have already jumped in to start using the crowdsourcing. So good job with you and Eric and John working that out for us. Thanks a lot.
Hey, Derek. Yes. Sorry to interrupt here. I do have a question for you and Chris that came in the chat. The question is from Nathan and Kelly Wood. Does the council have a combined federal campaign number? Looking at how do they use their combined CFC at work to designate to the council?
So
that's good. I'll jump. That's going to need a professional staff member to answer, I think.
Sorry, Chris. I'll jump in. We do have a CFC number. I don't have it right now to give out, but we can add that into the chat, or you can reach out to either me or Eric Ouellette, and we can get it out to you.
Great, thanks, Derek. So we do have one, and Nathan Kelly, I will put in the chat of your question, who to reach out directly via email to secure that number. One last question for the good of the group too, as well. This relates to fundraising on Facebook, where a lot of people will designate a local council or a favorite charity to raise funds for their birthday. It came in from Adam here in Hooksett, I believe. We are currently working through the application process to have Daniel Webster Council listed as a approved Facebook charity. There is a slight hold in the application process, but as soon as we have that available, we'll make that widely known to everybody. But in the interim, a great resource is designating Daniel Webster Council through your Amazon Smile program. 0.5% of your purchase will get returned back to supporting scouting here locally. So Facebook charity program coming soon, but Amazon Smile is an immediate way to support the council.
Yeah, and if you do follow that Help Scouts to 71777, you will get a link, and you can customize a message and you can post that straight to Facebook. So that's certainly a way. It won't be, you know, one of the Facebook charities for your birthday, but you can still post it onto your social media and use that.
Great, thanks, Chris. Appreciate all your help. Next up, we have Bob Sitar, who's our Council Leadership Development Chair and Assistant Council Commissioner, to talk with us a little bit about the virtual training and leadership development opportunities that we have. Bob?
Sure, thanks. For a couple of years, we've talked to the leadership development team about, you know, webinars or doing training in a remote fashion, and it's been one of those things that's sort of been neck-burnered. COVID has certainly pushed us into bringing training, and we're pleased that we've been able to run a number of trainings in this we call it virtual training. I like to think of it as distance learning, to use the educational phrase, because it certainly has applications on just the environment that we find ourselves in. We've run chartered organizational representative training. We are in the middle of a scout leader training and cub training. There we've got participation of 18 in the scout leader training, 24 in the cub leader training. Certainly, I think much larger than a lot of the individual districts would run as courses. We're in the middle of running a ed training, advanced presentation for scouters. And all are going very well. We've had some requests to extend into crew advisor and crew commit training, and we're taking a look at those. Also, the idea has been floated about doing a, we haven't really come up with a good name, but I'll call it a scouting seminar, where, you know, maybe an hour a week, we would touch on various topics as they relate to scouting. These would not be necessarily formal BSA trainings, but would be more along the lines of something you might see at a University of Scouting. So very, very short, very concise, and you know, just to this is flowing. So once we do get back into the other 75% of scouting, which is outing, we will be as energetic as we were before all of this hit. If you have any questions regarding training, you can send an email to training@nhscouting.org. If you have any ideas or things that you would like to see as we start fleshing out the scouting seminar, please send those ideas along as well. We'd love to hear them. Derek, back to you.
Great, Bob. Thanks. I appreciate it. Some good stuff coming up and some good ideas getting ready to go. So thanks a lot for all your work on doing that. Next up, we have Patrick Grace, who's Daniel Webster Council's Vice President of Operations. He'd like to share some information with us and provide a few updates. Patrick.
Thanks, Derek, and welcome, everybody. This is a little bit more back office work than what you've been hearing thus far, but back in December, the Executive Board decided to create an ad hoc committee to look at how we deliver service to our units and families within Daniel Webster Council. So I got tapped to do that particular job, and I pulled together a team of council level, district level, and unit level volunteers to take a look at exactly that, how we deliver service. So over the past couple of months, we've been heads down collecting some data and conducting a survey, that you have, most of you, or many of you have seen already. And that survey is basically to ask you, what is it we can do to better serve you, to what you like about Daniel Webster Council service model, what you don't like about it, and how we are being represented in the communities. The information we're gathering through both our objective data collection and our subjective data collection survey is very, very telling and very informative. But we haven't quite got down into the weeds with the data yet. That's our next step in the process as we launch our data review and to determine what we can do to help you grow scouting in your communities. If you haven't had an opportunity to participate in the survey, I believe, Derek, we're sending it out again after this meeting. And we will ask you to go ahead and take a moment and fill out, I think it's about 20 or so questions. But to give us your information, give us your feedback so we can take a look at what you need from us so we can grow scouting in New Hampshire. So the process at this point in time is still data collection. We're still looking at the different models that are available to us, and we're looking at what is it you need from us to be successful. And that's really all I have to offer at this point, Derek. Any questions for me?
Great, Patrick. Thank you. Appreciate your leadership in this process and data collection. And for those of you in a Unit Key 3, you should have received the invitation to take the survey. And just prior to coming on to this evening's webinar, you probably got a reminder email if you had not yet taken the survey to please do that. So if you can, please help Patrick and his group out with data collection so that we can use that to better serve the needs of scouting here in New Hampshire. Tyler, do we have any other questions as we wind down this evening?
Yes, thanks, Derek. We have one more question we haven't had a chance to address yet throughout this evening. Regarding enrollment or charter fee increases that may be scheduled for 2021, and any discussion from the council for registration fee relief due to family situations for COVID-19. I believe John Arica, our council commissioner, will have an opportunity to address that a little bit as well. But I wanted to get to Michael to let him know that our question, we will answer his question. And then one last one before we get there. National Jamboree, we do have a contingent going. I'll put the point of contact into the chat there.
Tyler, you want me to answer the question now?
Yes, and as it relates to that too, one final one that came in is whether or not Daniel Webster Council is considering bankruptcy.
All right, so I'm going to take care of the last question first. The answer is no, the Daniel Webster Council is not considering bankruptcy at all. We are in pretty good shape financially right now. One of the things that we operate on is we have about a $3.7 to $4 million annual budget, and we pretty much take in about $3.7 to $4 million on an annual basis. So typically we operate on a break-even basis. If we can break even in a year, then we're doing well. And that's why it's very important that, Chris talked earlier about Friends of Scouting and why it's important that we, that everybody supports Friends of Scouting. And then the same with the various fundraisers that we have, be it the Adventure Cards or the Maple Syrup. One of the things we're looking at potentially is a hike-a-thon, bringing that back to the council, which we once had and went away. So, we're looking at other ways in terms of how do we get, how do the units have more opportunities to raise funds and keep those funds in your units and everything. But to answer your question, no, the Daniel Webster Council is not filing bankruptcy, nor is it even a consideration. So, I don't think anybody asked this question, but if you did, just to let you know, we did file for the payroll protection plan and everything, and that's really because we wanted to make sure we kept a level of service to our units and to our volunteers and everything. So that's why people such as Skip Chase, Josh Boucher, Colin Butler, Tyler Yankee. That's why all these guys are they're still working. They're doing everything that they need to be doing, and everything. So, that was certainly key for us. In terms of registration fees, so as you know, there's a couple of components on registration fees. The first is the national fees, and that is something we have zero control over. At this point in time, we have not heard anything from the national office in terms of any form of relief or anything like that from the national office. So at this point in time, we cannot speak to that. The other fee that does exist at registration time is also the Daniel Webster Council fee, which is the insurance, basically covers the insurance. And if you remember last July, we had announced that it was going to go up to $12. And then when National increased their fee as late in the year as they did, we kind of rolled back our fee a little bit from the $12 to $6, but that was a one-year deal. So at this point in time, the Daniel Webster fee this year is scheduled to be at $12. There has been some discussion amongst a few of the board members at the moment in terms of what do we do with the insurance fee if depending upon situations. So to be completely honest with you at the moment, we have been really kind of focused on summer camp in terms of are we going to be able to provide our units and our scouts with a summer camp. We've been focused on making sure that the needs of the council from a short term on this short term basis are met. And so for the most part, from a fee perspective, that is not something it's on our plate to look at and review, but it is not anything that has been decided upon at this point in time.
Thanks, John. Appreciate the details and information there and the follow-up. As we wind down the roundtable this evening, I just want to again thank everyone for your time this evening and participating with us. as we went through the roundtable meeting, and hopefully we were able to share some great information with you and bring you up to date on some of the things that are happening and are coming along for the Daniel Webster Council. So as we close out this evening, I'd like to introduce our Scout Executive, Jay Gary, who has some thoughts for us as we close out tonight. Jay?
Thank you, Derek, and good evening, everybody. I'm actually really overwhelmed by a really great response tonight with certainly over 200 people, 200 scouters here this evening to join us for the roundtable discussion and become more informed about scouting. I know this is a really tough time for our scouts, for our families, and for our unit leaders. And I have to say, it's very inspiring to see the creativity, the enthusiasm, the excitement that's generated around just general scout spirit about how to deliver the best scouting program possible to our youth, despite the challenges that we have. You know, just to put things into perspective a little bit, of course, we've been around for 110 years as an organization. And when you think about the history and legacy of scouting, we've adapted to a whole number of changing circumstances over our entire history. You know, in 1918, in the Spanish flu, if you read anything about the history, the scouts actually were around just 8 years in its infancy from the origination of scouting to help collect medicine and supplies and actually help deliver them to households as good service projects. You think about a whole number of times when scouting's actually answered the call of service, whether it was World War II for war bonds or just to collect copper, because quite frankly, there wasn't enough metal to produce ammunition and help the front lines of the military. You know, we've seen our times through economic crisis over the decades. We've certainly seen our share of natural disasters. In fact, when I was in Long Island, scouts were critical in terms of helping Hurricane Sandy victims with issues related to their homes or helping the Red Cross with food distribution sites in the middle of December when people didn't have heat and they ran out of electricity or gasoline. Scouts have always been there, and the families and the leaders have stepped up to those circumstances and really made a bright spot for the community. And I really want to commend everybody who's pitched in on those efforts. Maybe you made donations, maybe you encouraged scouts to participate in the Scout Supports Hospitals initiative, which has been great to see, especially those young scouts showing up at the hospital with a couple of cases of things just to say thank you to our first responders and, you know, those direct care personnel that are working so hard in this challenging environment. You know, on my background, you see survive, emerge, and thrive. Those are three words we're embracing as a council specifically to help us survive the pandemic, of course, and make sure that scouting emerges from this to be as successful as we possibly can be so that we can thrive in our future. And we're actually looking forward beyond these issues. And one of the things that's actually really also encouraging is to see so many questions tonight about everybody so interested in camp. I mean, everybody wants to know, what's the status of fees? You know, where are we gonna be able to go? When are we gonna be able to go? Are we still gonna be able to do this? I think everybody's itching to get outside, right? So I think the key for us as a council is to really put all of our focus right now into offering the best possible solutions we can for scouting in terms of camps. We know this summer that we're gonna have to adapt to some change. There's going to be social distancing. There's going to be group requirements. There may be changes to situations like housing or delivery of food service, and we're awaiting some of those things. Actually, in fact, the CDC just released guidelines today for camps, and tomorrow we're going to be on a conference call with the state to talk about the state directives related to how to facilitate our camping operations, and that's the first time that the state's actually started talking about how are we going to run our summer camps when we start to come back to work? So certainly we're going to ask for a lot of cooperation from all of you, and you've been great so far. And I really appreciate the patience of so many people to wait for our updates, to hear about what's coming. We will do our best to continue to communicate to you our changes. I know some of you are itching to get back to your troop meetings, and we have to wait just a little bit longer to make sure that we can put you back into the program safely. And that you have the proper requirements that you need as leaders to ensure that our scouts are healthy, and then when they go home to their families, that their families are healthy. So I can't emphasize enough my gratitude to all of you as volunteers. You know, you are the front delivery people who are ensuring that the scouts are getting the best quality program. These remote activities you're coming up with, the scavenger hunts, the remote camperees, the remote campfires, the online programming, the things we're seeing on YouTube, it's very dynamic and it's really exciting. And that's what makes us Granite strong as a state. So I really appreciate the efforts that all of you are putting forth to make sure that happened. Our number one goal over the next couple of weeks will be to ensure that we can open Camp Carpenter effectively, assuming that we're allowed to do that, and that we can also open up GSR and our other properties safely and effectively for our scouts. So we'll be having a lot of communication with all of you about what's going to be required in order to ensure that we have a safe environment. Not all those answers are known, and it's going to be a very fluid situation over the next couple of weeks. The last thing I want to say, of course, is, you know, my appreciation to all of the folks that are really keeping those regular things going that scouts rely upon, particularly our online merit badge programming, to our training committee for doing a great job in terms of online training and keeping our leaders engaged and planning for their future, to the advancement committee. I sat in on a 3-hour session with the Life to Eagle seminar, and I watched a bunch of Eagle Scout candidates literally equipping themselves with future projects and things that they wanted to do. So scouting has not stopped, and we are going to ensure that we emerge from this and that we thrive for it as the best possible council we can be. And we certainly appreciate all of your feedback, your enthusiasm, and most particularly, your volunteerism. Thank you for everything that you do sincerely on behalf of our staff and on behalf of our board and all of those who help to make for you a great council. So with that, I'll turn it over to John Errico to close us out. And John, you're on mute.
Thank you, Jay. I too want to thank all the leaders who are making scouting possible during this time. For many of our youth, they are perhaps facing the greatest challenge of their young lives. They, as well as you, are facing a challenge that has knocked all of us back. But many of you have risen to the challenge and have pushed forward when others may have given up. You have refused to quit or be defeated. You took the obstacles only to strengthen your resolve to provide the best possible program for our youth. It is through those obstacles that you have shown your youth how character is built and how to shape your legacy. With each obstacle, we learn something new about ourselves. These obstacles provide us an opportunity to demonstrate to our youth how we learn, grow, and adapt. With each challenge we attempt to fix, failure is always possible, but we show that failure is not the end, but only a step on the path to success. You are making the impossible possible. It is your determination, your focus, your relentless pursuit to keep our youth engaged, your declaring yourself as unstoppable, your thankfulness and appreciation for what you have, and you're helping others in their time of need. Years from now, your scouts will remember what you did for them during the crazy times of 2020. Make your actions continue to inspire others. Stay safe and be well, and enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you very much for attending.